morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 21st meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is a declaration of interests, and can I invite Graeme Simpson, who's joining the committee in place of Craig Hoy, to declare any relevant interests.
Thanks, Convener. I have no relevant interests to declare.
Thank you very much indeed, and I'll just take this opportunity again to place on record my thanks to the contribution that Craig Hoy made to the work of this committee over the last 2 years. Agenda item two is a decision for members of the committee to agree or not to take business in private. So can I ask members of the committee if they are agreeable to take in agenda items 4, 5 and 6 in private this morning? We are agreed. Thank you very much for that. Our principal item on the agenda this morning is consideration of the Audit Scotland report, how the Scottish Government is set up to deliver climate change goals, governance and risk management arrangements for net zero targets and adaptation outcomes. I might just use the shorter title for the future of the meeting. But we are pleased to welcome three witnesses from the Scottish Government this morning to give us evidence on that. And I'm pleased to welcome Roy Brannan, who's the Director General Net Zero. Alongside Mr. Brannan is Kirsty Burge, who's the Director of Energy and Climate Change in the Scottish Government, and they're joined by Phil Raines. Phil is the Deputy Director for Domestic Climate Change in the Scottish Government. We've got quite a number of questions to ask this morning, but before we get to those questions, Mr. Brannan, can I ask you to make a short opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thanks for the opportunity to come to speak with the committee today on the report prepared by Audit Scotland. As you say, I'm joined by my colleagues Kirsty Burge, Director of Energy and Climate Change, and Phil Raines, Deputy Director of Domestic Climate Change, who have the day-to-day responsibility for climate change oversight activity. The twin challenges of climate change and biodiversity loss require not just active and determined leadership, but all the experience and focus that the public sector can bring to governance, planning and delivery. That challenge has a threefold element in Scotland. It covers mitigation, reducing carbon emissions in line with the targets, just transition, ensuring that we pursue climate change policies that minimise impacts on the most vulnerable but maximises the benefits of the transition, and adaptation, helping Scotland adapt to the locked-in impacts of climate change. The report by Audit Scotland clearly sets out the journey we have been undertaking to develop governance and risk management that is right for a programme of work that continues to evolve. It noted how we have made significant improvements in our programme approach over the years and rightly noted the ways in which we can further improve. We welcome those recommendations and we have committed to implementing them as soon as possible. Indeed, as I hope the discussion today will demonstrate, we have taken important strides already. We've built on the existing governance of the climate change programme and are developing streamlined, more clearly presented sets of roles, responsibilities and relationships at all levels throughout the programme. We have matured the approach to risk with clear processes around risk identification, escalation, action and monitoring. And we have put in place a new programming secretariat to drive forward these improvements. As always, we are happy to attempt to answer any questions you have on aspects of the governance and risk activity from this Audit Scotland report. And if we can't, we're happy to follow up in writing. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Brannan. I think that, sets out some helpful parameters that we will be guided by to ask our questions this morning. I'm going to begin by asking the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to get us underway with some opening questions. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I ask what impact, if any, has the joint review of budget had on matters related to climate change on the Scottish Government's governance and risk management arrangements for meeting its net zero targets and adaptation outcomes?
So I'll start and then I'll bring Kirsty in on this. So the joint budget review settled on three things that we were going to do differently at the end of the process. One, which is to strengthen how climate change is recognised in the budget, and you saw that from the text that was included in the budget for 23-24. The second is to look at an improved taxonomy for future budgets, so working across the piece on every line, identifying what those lines will contribute in terms of emissions reductions. And then the third area, which is still in development, but we'll undertake a pilot of this at the tail end of this year, is to develop an assessment process of policies. So I think you perhaps heard from Alison Irvine, Interim Chief Executive TS, at the major infrastructure session, that TS have already introduced a kind of policy check, if you like, on climate change impact as part of their process. So what we'd look to do is to develop that further so that as we go forward over the years, that every policy will go through a similar framework. But Kirsty.
Yeah, maybe add probably just one thing on that and bring Phil in as well. So far you'll be aware that our assessment, our carbon assessment of the budget has focused on the capital budget. So we're looking to bring in an assessment of the revenue budget as well, so it covers all of the budget. And on the pilot, I suppose taking a step back, and we talked about this in the infrastructure committee as well, this is working out how we do the carbon assessment of policies is something governments across the world are looking at. So we are seeking to improve how we do that on an ongoing basis, and how we assure that throughout the different levels of the Scottish Government. But Phil, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
The only thing I might add is this is about embedding the way that the priority placed upon climate change, apparent in the policy perspectives and indeed from the programme for government that got published this week. It's about embedding that in the way that decisions get made through the governance chain regarding budgets, so that the information's there, it's apparent, it's there for Parliament as well to consider as part of the decisions they make, to make sure that when those decisions about budgets are going forward, both the internal ones that ministers might need to consider in terms of thinking about what they wish to propose to Parliament, as well as Parliament's own consideration of it, that information's there in a way that makes sense. So all these three things are there, very much from the Fraser-Vallander report that underlay it. So it's about embedding it within the governance structure that exists within the budget process right the way through to this building.
Okay, thank you. You actually mentioned it there. It says in the report about embedding climate change considerations into the financial and policy decision-making processes. And obviously the DG for Net Zero has to work with all the other DGs to ensure that climate change is considered in the activities that they lead on. So can you tell us about the work that you're undertaking as the Portfolio Accountable Officer to ensure climate change is considered in each of the government directories by the other Portfolio Accountable Officers?
Yeah, so there's quite a bit of overlap here because as one of eight DGs, I sit on the executive team. So that kind of scrutiny and cross-collaboration, for instance, on DG economy work on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, there is quite a bit of connection and overlap in terms of just identifying how different policies are taken forward in relation to climate change. On the Global Climate Emergency Board, for instance, we have Director of Spending from the Exchequer sitting on the board. We have all the directors of all the sectors sitting on the board, and we also have directors from DG Economy sitting on the board. So there's quite a bit of insight and scrutiny on the activity that's been taken forward in relation to climate change work. On the budget, then the budget is by necessity developed as a group of directorates, with ministers, and then collectively with the executive team, and then with cabinet. So that process, again, climate change will feature as part of that process as we run through it.
Could I ask as well at what point the DGs have involvement in announcements? So the likes of with the First Minister's programme for government was announced on Tuesday. So what involvement do you have in that? And one specifically I was kind of looking at, there's obviously a huge carbon footprint with housing. So there's an announcement for an investment of £750 million to support the delivery of affordable homes. There's also £25 million to provide homes for key workers and invest in £60 million to acquire empty properties for use as affordable homes. I don't know if that 25 and 60 is included within the 750 or not, but do you have involvement before those announcements are made and what the carbon footprint would be? Do all the director generals get together, discuss it, and is there minutes of all the meetings?
Yeah, so we're venturing out with governance and risk of climate change, mm-hmm, more into generally how government operates.
Yeah.
But I'm happy enough to try and answer that. So DGs and their directorates provide policy advice to ministers in developing those elements of policy that ministers want to take forward, and that's what the culmination of that is, the PFG.
Okay, I do have more governance questions, but I'll come back in and then.
Right, thanks. I mean, Mr. Brannan, you mentioned taxonomy, which is the classification of spending, isn't it, into kind of high, medium, low carbon impact and so on. And Mr. Rains, you mentioned the Fraser-Valander Institute. I mean, when I look at some of the commentary of the Fraser-Valander Institute, they are quite critical of your taxonomy. They say these classifications are very broad. For example, all health spending is classified as neutral spending, regardless of the underlying activity. This risks misclassifying high emission activities as beneficial or carbon reduction activities as harmful. It is not known what emissions impact a spend classified as high, low or neutral emissions actually has. I mean, that's a fairly fundamental criticism of the model that you're using. So it says that, so they say both the high level carbon assessment and taxonomy carbon assessment of the capital budget methodologies are, in our view, unable to provide an adequate level of scrutiny and transparency. How do you respond to that?
So that's why we undertook the GBR, and that's what the work that Scottish Exchequer colleagues in collaboration with climate change colleagues are taking forward to develop that methodology and mature it so that it covers both resource and capital. And that work's underway.
So when can we expect to see that?
For this budget coming up.
Okay. I've got more questions on related areas to that, but I'm going to turn to Colin Beattie, who's got some things to put to you. Colin.
I do have some specific questions for you, but I'd like to ask you a more general one to begin with. A lot of the work the Scottish Government's done is fairly well developed in terms of climate change, and you know, a huge amount has been done, if you like, on that side of the balance sheet. The other side is how are you going to afford this? Where's the money coming from? In a different committee, I was one of the witnesses referred to a wall of private finance, because clearly the government doesn't have all the money that's needed to affect this. That wall of private finance has to be tapped into. It has to be shown that there are viable projects which will give a good return on their investment. How are we tapping into that? How are we communicating with this wall? Are we doing it through the UK government? Are we doing it directly? How are we going to compete? How are we going to be competitive against the rest of the particularly the developed world, which will be looking for exactly that same money?
Yeah, those are the strands of activity that both DG Net Zero and DG Economy are working on in terms of investable propositions, effectively. And if I use some of the examples in transport, because that's where it's more recent, I guess, we managed to secure a good level of private investment in the transformation of the bus fleet to low-carbon fleet by pump priming with Scottish Government money, and similar piece of work now underway on electric vehicle charging points. And I think that's where we need to see the use of public money be much more in that frame going forward. And I know Gregor Irwin, DG Economy, has clear bits of work underway to identify those markets that are available and looking for a home to invest in, and the challenges that we face. Hydrogen is a good example of that, where we think we've got a good marketable proposition, then to present those two things together. Going back to the budget, I think it's 23-24 is the largest on record in terms of spend on climate change, 2.2 billion, but it is still short of what it will require to transform society level a country of Scotland's size, and that's well recognised. And I think, Mr. Beattie, I think you're absolutely right. The key thing is to make marketable propositions, to have the right engagement with investors, and then to match those two up so that hopefully we can start to produce a kind of clearer pathway for some of these interventions that are going to require much more than public funding. But Kirsty, I don't know if you want to say any more on investment.
Yeah, I mean, it's It's absolutely critical, as you say, that we lever in private sector finance, and we do it in a range of ways. So, for example, the Scottish National Investment Bank has a really important role to play. What happens in practice is that for projects and investments which aren't on their own commercially viable, as Roy says, there is a role for some public sector money to come in and leverage that. And I guess the role it plays is it sends a signal that the government is really serious about this sector, and we will do what we can with our levers to ensure it develops. So, for example, in hydrogen, and that can help leverage in public sector, private sector money. So Scottish National Investment Bank is an example of that. The work that Scottish Enterprise and the enterprise agencies do to support investments is another example. And these investments will almost always, unless it's in the very early stage of sort of technological development, require co-investment by the private sector as well. So in the areas where, you know, we see there are significant new market opportunities, Roy has mentioned hydrogen, there will be parts of transport, carbon capture and storage, industrial transformation, also in decarbonising our building stock, there's a range of levers. So as a Scottish National Investment Bank, enterprise agencies, and then, as we talked about in the Infrastructure Investment Committee, we have a number of funds, Industrial Transformation Fund, for example, that we run ourselves, and there's sort of core funding from the Scottish Government, and we work together with private sector investment.
I've seen various figures given for the money that's going to be needed to fund this transition, and all of them are eye-watering. What seems to have been done so far is relatively, compared to that, quite small. We're going to have to tap into huge sums of money, billions and billions, over a period. There is going to be competition for that money from everywhere. How well developed are our links into private finance to ensure that Scotland receives its fair share of funding in terms of this, and that we can produce enough viable projects? Because some of these projects are not necessarily profitable, but nevertheless need done. And that would imply public funding as opposed to private funding. How is this all being brought together? Is there a group who are working on this, maintaining these relationships and contacts, developing them, and ensuring that there is a pipeline?
Yeah, so if I'd known we were going to cover this off, I probably would have invited DG Economy along, Gregor, because that's exactly what his remit is to take effectively the challenges that I have in getting us to net zero, marketable propositions, and then engaging with the investment community to go, what can you do and how can we work together to make a proposition that will allow us to deliver both on the journey towards net zero, but also that investment that we need. So that's his principal focus as a DG Economy, and his team are focused in on identifying those marketable, investable propositions, whether that's in ScotWind or whether that's in other areas. I mean, one area that we know we're going to have to work quite hard on, and we've already got work underway, it falls under Kirsty's remit, is the heat and buildings transformation. So heat and buildings transformation is significant. We've got a large amount of properties that we need to transform over the piece for heat and buildings to contribute their portion of the journey towards net zero. And we've got to find propositions that will be acceptable to homeowners and others, and a marketable proposition as we start to move the transition in terms of energy efficiency and low emission heating systems. So, again, we're probably venturing quite far away from the governance and risk of the Audit Scotland report, but hopefully it gives you some confidence that that's the piece of work, and the link up between that cross-collaboration piece between two DGs effectively as part of the ET.
I'm sure some of my colleagues will have questions in this also. Let me move on to more specific. The Auditor General's report talks about the Deputy Director Network as a key climate change governance body. And that it has responsibility for delivering on policies within the climate change plan update. But it operates informally, no minutes of the meeting. Is there a reason why there's no minutes of the meeting? I mean, how are decisions taken? How are decisions recorded? How are decisions communicated?
So this is the journey we've been on since I came into the post. The GCE board set up in 2019 was very strategic in nature. And my background, as you know now, is around delivery. So my focus as I came in was to try and reorientate both the GCE board and the structures supporting it to focus much more in the programme, the building blocks, what we need to do, what we need to measure, and then how do we assure ourselves that that's in place. And the Audit Scotland report was a timely kind of insight into how mature we had got to that point. Since then, we have revised the terms of reference for the GCE. We've established a new governance framework that more clearly sets out the roles of all the individuals involved in climate change delivery, including the role of that DD group, which we no longer see as a pivotal part of the governance structure, but support to the GCE board. And I'll say a bit more about why we've done that. And then, as well as that, we've also developed the risk framework for the climate change programme to be held by the GCE board. Setting aside that we had a very, very well-developed risk process at the DG family level, recognising that this GCE board needs to have an oversight of those climate change risks that flow through the programme. So the governance framework now has all the different boards that flow directly up to GCE. So we're effectively streamlining it by taking out the DD network and using that as a support mechanism only to the GCE board. So the board on transport, for instance, Transport Climate Change Transformation Board, their reporting mechanisms will flow to the GCE board, and it will be for the GCE board to assure on a regular basis the activity of each of these sectors. So that's what we've done in the interim period between the report and now. And speaking to the Auditor General earlier, what I've agreed to do is for the team to engage on an ongoing basis now on those artefacts as they are developed, so that Audit Scotland can continue that process of just assuring that we are working through those recommendations in a timely fashion.
But what's in people's heads that they produce no minutes?
Thank you.
A keyboard, no minutes.
We do now produce minutes, which are provided to the programme board.
Was there any logic behind not producing minutes and meeting informally?
It took the form as providing support for the GCE programme board. But we recognise, as Roy has been saying, that the formality of the procedures, very much strengthened by the Audit Scotland's recommendations, is something we did need to revisit, and we have revisited. And in part, of looking at governance and looking at programme management is sometimes an exercise in what you might think of as gardening. We have been trying to find ways to rationalise and make more sense of the governance structures there and avoid unnecessary duplication, as well as formalising the processes for those bits which are still there.
And I think just to add to that, again, it comes back to the journey that we've been on with the establishment of these structures. The GCE board, when set up, was a direct response to the former First Minister's climate change emergency at the time, but also in a very strategic space. So what is it that needs to happen? We're now past that point. So we've climate change plan update. We know what needs to be delivered. And the process now has been to move that much more into the delivery space. And that's flowed through to artefacts that, for instance, very early on in my tenure in 2020, establishing a dashboard that we could take to the executive team in delivery mode so that they could get sight of those building blocks across the seven sectors and the progress on those outcomes and those indicators. So, Mr. Beattie, it's a journey that we have been on. The DD support board network was, in effect, a mechanism to support the GC at that point. It didn't have a formal role, where with the new governance framework, I've formalised that so that we've now got the boards for each of the sectors reporting directly into GC.
So is the Auditor General incorrect in that this Deputy Director Network is responsible for delivering on policies within the climate change plan update? Is that?
No, that's
they
not.
Never had that.
No, it's not incorrect. They were, for
so
instance,
it's correct.
It is correct. So I mean, for instance, and I'll bring Phil in
so
on this.
So perform the key role informally.
The development of the climate change plan, if you like, the development of the sectoral changes, the DD board would have had oversight and strategic intervention on those policies as they then were considered by the
informally.
GC board. Formally.
I'm happy. Sorry, I'm happy to come in a bit on this. Yep. So policy obviously gets delivered at all levels in government. And we'll discuss it at team level, we'll discuss it at divisional level with deputy directors and at director level. So I think and the policy gets scrutinised as you go up the chain. So, for example, in the development of the climate change plan, this starts in teams, goes through units, goes through deputy directors, through the deputy director network, and then goes to the GCE board. And at all levels, that policy is scrutinised. So I will discuss with my deputy directors what we're doing in the sectors I'm responsible for. And then the papers, with quite a lot of detail, then go into the GCE board. So there is substantive scrutiny through the GCE board of what comes up through the deputy director network. You know, that said, we agree that we should probably have been taking minutes from that, because that increases that transparency. It's another layer on top of the papers that go up. So we accept that. But as Roy says, where we're moving now is it's formally acknowledged as that kind of working group that helps support the analysis and the papers that go to the GCE board.
Is it fair to say that unsatisfactory governance issue that's been highlighted here by the Auditor General no longer exists?
That's correct. So it will be a supporting group to the GCE board. So the GCE board, if the GCE board want something to be developed in strategic terms, then we'll get the DD network to discuss and evolve that first. But in terms of the reporting on activity across the seven sectors towards net zero, you'll get a streamlined approach from the sectors to the GCE board through a monitoring framework, and then in turn from the GCE board to the Cabinet Subcommittee on Climate Change.
So let's move on to another governance issue. The Auditor General's made multiple references to gaps on climate governance linked to adaptation, both in his report and in an evidence session on the 18th May. What progress is the Scottish Government making to address gaps in governance and capacity linked to climate adaptation ahead of producing the next climate adaptation programme?
I'll bring Kirsty in a minute on that. So the climate change adaptation is now one of the three key pillars of the climate change programme that will be overseen by the GCE board. So climate change mitigation, adaptation and just transition, as I said in my opening statement. I think it's fair to say, and Auditor General is right, that adaptation, not just in this country but across the world, is always lags behind the focus on mitigation. When I came in, I stuck it on our DG risk network, risk register, quite early on in 22, and then escalated that through the internal governance processes to the corporate risk register to give it more focus. We've had deep dives on adaptation at ET level and at Cabinet Subcommittee, if I remember rightly. But we need to, again, formalise the responsibility for delivery of those changes that are going to be required on adaptation across all the sectors. So Transport, for instance, have published recently their kind of approach to adaptation over the next climate change adaptation plan period. As we go into the development of the next climate change adaptation plan, which we will start in the end of this year, start 24, as we have to statutorily to do, that will include, and this is the hard bit, is working on a monitoring and evaluation framework, where nobody has done this anywhere else at the minute, a robust monitoring and evaluation framework. So you need to be able to identify, again, on flooding, for instance, what is it that we will do? You can have a general statement that says we will do everything we possibly can to transform the country to safeguard ourselves across flooding, but trying to get that more specificity into that process of what we will do by when is the work of the next climate change adaptation plan. But Kirsty?
Just to put something in here, the Auditor General's report also identified key challenges in terms of workforce capacity and capability, and that climate change is competing with other areas for funding and staff. How are you addressing that?
So last year, as an ET with the new Perm Sec, we went through a process of looking again at our resourcing needs as a government, aligned to the priorities of government with the budget available. And that resulted in a break, if you like, on workforce recruitment at that stage until we all had gone through a process of workforce planning. And from the DG family, recognising that we were establishing as a completely new DG family in 2021, bringing different directorates together, expanding. We then, at the start of the tail end of last year, start of this year, did our workforce planning as directorates. So Kirsty, and for the DEC directorate, identifying the staff that she would be required to deliver on the government's programme with the budget available. That workforce plan was then presented to ET, ratified, and those are the numbers that we are now working to between now and 24 as the first data point and then the end of the Parliament. So as a DG family, we are due to increase slightly in a couple of key directorates. So in DEC, we will have increased by about 100 staff since 2022 to 24, and that's recognising the programmes that we have in heat and buildings and other activity that are key to delivery of climate change. In Scotland, we have established a whole new directorate because, again, that's a key tenet of our transition to energy transformation. So as a DG family, we are one of the DG families which will grow, recognising the challenge of climate change and our need to deliver. But over the longer term, the trend is to become more efficient and reduce our headcount so that it is fit and right for the size of organisation, the budget, the pipeline of activity and the resources that we've got.
It appears on that you've still got a bit of a challenge ahead of you. Let me move on, I'm conscious of time. The Verity House Agreement, which was signed recently between the Scottish Government and local government, it sets out how both parties are going to work together to deliver shared priorities, including climate change. What impact, if any, will this new agreement have on the Scottish Government's existing governance and risk management arrangements?
So it's a good area to pick up on. So for some time we've been doing quite a bit of work with the Seven Cities Alliance, now Eight Cities Alliance, on the transition to net zero. So establishing a kind of pathway to work together on key things like EV infrastructure, like fleet procurement. The Chief Executive of Aberdeen City helped to develop that further beyond the eight cities to a proposal that would bring in COSLA, SOLAS and local authorities more generally. And we see the development of that co-working, if you like, on climate change delivery as being a kind of front tenet of the new Verity House Agreement. So there's been early discussions with our colleagues on what a framework would look like in that space. One of the early wins that we will take forward, which was already going ahead of Verity House, was an intelligence climate system, which would gather data on a regimented basis across all 32 local authorities. So we've got consistency of approach in terms of data sourcing, and we've agreed to kind of co-take that forward. So I see it as a really helpful way to kind of formalise some of the activity that we'd already established. So we knew that we can't do this as national government alone. It needs other public bodies, not just the ones that I look after, but local authority. And I think the Verity House Agreement just gives us a stronger foundation in which to drive that forward at a political level. But Kirsty, I don't know if you want to say any more on that.
Yeah, no, I think the only thing I'd say is I think we're in a fairly good place, actually, in terms of our experience with working with local government, because we recognised for a long time that local government obviously has a huge role to play in climate change. But it's also a newish role because it's not the kind of, you know, it's slightly different functions. So for example, we've worked really closely with local government to develop local heat and energy efficiency strategies where local government will set out, you know, what areas are most appropriate for development of heat networks. And we've been working with them on transport to provide, you know, working to provide charging infrastructure, for example. So I think this is actually an area where we're building on some strengths.
Okay. Let me just, again, I'm conscious of time, let me just briefly ask you about The Auditor General's report again talks about the Cabinet Subcommittee on the Climate Emergency, and he states it's unclear what the role of the Cabinet Subcommittee is. What is the role of the Cabinet Subcommittee on the Scottish Government's governance and risk arrangements for net zero targets and adaptation and outcomes?
So the Cabinet Subcommittee was set up to look at and take decisions on those aspects that come forward from the Global Climate Emergency Board on our journey to net zero. So, for instance, over the course of the last year, we have taken the agricultural reform programme to the Cabinet Subcommittee, taken a steer from the committee on how that would develop into the legislation that will go forward now. We've taken forward transport, we've taken forward adaptation, and we're now in the process of taking forward the work of the new plan. So the new plan and the work that the policy teams are developing goes in front of the Cabinet Subcommittee.
If I asked you to summarise just in a very brief sentence or whatever, what their key function is?
They're taking decisions on the journey to net zero and then ratified by the full Cabinet in due course.
Why isn't it clearer? I mean, I'm referring to the Auditor General's report.
I'm unclear about why that's unclear. As a Cabinet Subcommittee of the Cabinet, the full Scottish Cabinet, that's its role.
I might just add, there was a paper that went before the Programme Board, at the last Programme Board, which sets out very clearly the roles and responsibilities for every part of the governance. So where there was any lack of clarity before, we've now got that formally written down, there are clear terms of reference, and there are clear roles and responsibilities for every chain. And what Roy said, I guess, with regard to the Cabinet Subcommittee, is presented there as that.
Okay, I'll leave it at that. Thank you, Convener.
I think Graeme Simpson wants to come in on this Cabinet Subcommittee point. Graeme.
Yeah, I was looking to see if I could find any minutes for the Cabinet Subcommittee, and I couldn't find any. Do you know if they're published?
I don't think they are published.
Is there a reason why they're not published?
Don't know.
So we do take minutes from the Cabinet Subcommittee, absolutely, as we should. The work that comes to Cabinet Subcommittee is policy work in development. And we have a very extensive, we might come on to this, we have a very extensive reporting framework on climate change, both mitigation and adaptation. And again, you know, as work goes through the various levels of government, both the official level and the political level, you know, we publish things to an extent. So similarly, you know, we don't publish cabinet minutes immediately after cabinet. Similarly with the this is a sub-cabinet committee. And just to be absolutely clear, we take very clear minutes from that. They are just not put in the public domain because it's considered that this is policy and development.
Yeah, but this is an important, well, important to you, an important committee. We as parliamentarians need to be able to scrutinise its work. And we can't do that if the minutes aren't published. Will you go away and reconsider this?
Well, it's not for me to reconsider that. I think that's just the mechanism of how government...
Well, who's it for?
How government and cabinet work, so cabinet secretariat. So I think that's one that we'll take away. As Kirsty says, policy and development has always been in that space where until a formal decision is taken by Cabinet, then it is policy and development. And in a case of the activity that goes forward into the Cabinet Subcommittee just now, there is a bit of iteration back and forward at the present time because that's what we're developing, is a policy that will finally go to Cabinet and decisions be taken on it.
Who chairs this committee?
It's Ms McCallum.
Okay. And how many members are on it?
It's from memory, I think we have 8 cabinet secretaries. It's not all the cabinet; it's all the cabinet secretaries with sector responsibility. But we can send the details in of the establishment of the committee and who's on the committee.
And relevant ministers, we might add as well.
Yeah.
Which makes it slightly different from cabinet.
Okay, I can leave it there.
Okay.
Maybe coming. I mean, it is obviously we've got the cabinet. We've got the Scottish Government has cabinet subcommittees in a number of different areas, and we, as I understand it, follow the procedures, which are, you know, the same as, or at least very similar to the way in which other cabinet subcommittees operate.
Can I bring it back to something which you do have control of? You've mentioned in response to Colin Beattie's early questions that partly, I presume, in light of the Audit Scotland report, you've reviewed the governance arrangements and the balance of responsibility between what was formerly and what is described in the Audit Scotland report as the engine room, which is Mr. Raines committed, the Deputy Director Network, to say that now there had been a kind of shift and it was very much the, you keep referring to it as the GC board, but I presume that's the Global Climate Emergency Board, if I understand it correctly. So two things arise from that for the committee, I think. One is, could you send us a copy of the new governance structure as it is now constituted? And secondly, as I say, coming on to something which appears to me you would have control over, in light of that change in governance structure, I understood the implication was you wouldn't be publishing in answer to the direct question the minutes of the Deputy Director Network, but would you be publishing the minutes of the GC Board, the Global, Global Climate Emergency Board?
No, because it falls into the same category. So it's a board that is...
Well, it's not in the same category. I mean, I understand why the Cabinet doesn't produce its minutes later on that same day, and that there are year-long rules about when and how Cabinet minutes might be produced. I get that. But this is a kind of operational strategic body, which might be, in Mr. Simpson's words, accountable to us as parliamentarians for the decisions that it's taken. I think there is quite a distinction between a cabinet and a cabinet subcommittee and this GC board.
So I think we're probably not going to agree on that, in the sense that the development of policy goes through the Global Climate Emergency Board, heads up to cabinet subcommittee, and then decisions taken on how that policy, either policy comes back for further development. So it's like any other mechanism of government. There are meetings and organisations and boards held which are in that development space. I think where we are in a very transparent space is in terms of the monitoring and impact of the outcomes of the work of the organisation. So we publish on an annual basis in May this year a 310-page report on each sector and their progress towards delivery of the outcomes and indicators in the climate change plan update. And that's the kind of public-facing element of how is government undertaking its business? How is it progressing towards climate change? Annually, we also are subject to the impacts of the review of the climate change targets and our climate change committee report on our progress made towards that. The transformation of the board as we move into more delivery focus, I suspect that we will produce artifacts through that process which will aid and enhance that level of external public scrutiny. But the actual day-to-day work of the board and its development of policy is like any other part of government, where it's those minutes are not formally published. It's not like a board which is delivering on only outcomes.
Well, I mean, I hear what you're saying, Mr. Brandon, but I reflect on what this committee was told when we took evidence from the Auditor General. And he said this, and this is what's in connection with the Deputy Director Network, which it seems to me to be a kind of lower level than this GC board. He said that there ought to be some formality. And he goes on to say, all that requires an additional level of formality. Minute taking is one of those fundamentals. So question one is there a minute taken of the GC board? And question two is, but you are refusing to publish that.
I'm not refusing to publish it. I'm just citing how government operates in that space where you're developing policy. Minutes are produced as at the end of every GCE board, and they are a record of that development of policy. But the policy development, including the production of the next climate change plan, quite rightly has to go through the governance structure of clearance by ministers. That's just normal course of business in developing a policy.
And so we then get to see none of that, is the That's that outcome, isn't it, Mr. Brandt?
Well, what comes out at the end of all of that is the production of the artefacts that will guide us towards net zero. In this case, development of policy and the climate change plan will be the consultation on the climate change plan, which everybody will have an opportunity to comment on as it passes its way through Parliament. And that includes those monitoring reports I mentioned that cover the sectorial progress towards their journey to climate change. So if committee members, I mean, we're happy enough the report's public, but happy enough to send in the details of that. But that report published in May, by sector, 300 pages, gives very detailed articulation of how each sector has progressed over the previous year on its journey towards climate change. And we do a similar thing on climate change adaptation.
Okay. We are a bit pressed for time, so I'm going to invite Willie Coffey to put a question to you.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Roy and colleagues. I just wanted to shift the discussion slightly to the kind of public behaviour, public participation element of this journey to net zero. Would you agree that probably one of the biggest nuts to crack is the problem of making the transition with heat in buildings, particularly in residential homes? And is it possible for you to give any kind of indication at the moment of how we're doing in that regard? There must be 2.5 million residential homes in Scotland. How many of them have got net zero heating systems?
So I'll bring Kirsty in on this, because this is the single biggest programme that Kirsty is responsible for. But just coming back to that general point on behavioural change and societal transformation, that in a nutshell is probably the hardest thing to undertake as we head on our journey to net zero. How we move ourselves, how we heat ourselves, what we consume, what we make of our land and marine-based assets, how we protect them. All of that is not just about interventions of EV charging, or it's about behaviour change as well. So that's quite a big step change, and that's an element that is difficult to measure. It's difficult to kind of move the dial on, but that's the journey that we're on, and that's the work of this GCE board, Global Climate Emergency Board, and the work of all the teams across each of the sectors. But specifically coming back to heating buildings, as one of the key sectors in terms of emissions, but also its contribution to our journey to net zero, the team are now wrestling with both the policy, how do you do it, and the delivery. What do we do now to try and support those that are most in need to be able to make their homes more energy efficient, to move towards zero emission boiler systems, heating systems, and then how do we establish a pattern that you can ramp that up and build a skill base in behind it so that we can get to 1 million homes by 2030. Sorry, Kirsty, I probably said too much.
I expect we'll probably be back at this committee talking about heating buildings, because this, you know, it is one of our biggest challenge. Buildings accounts for 20% of Scotland's emissions, and you know we have done a fantastic job in Scotland, I think, of reducing emissions. It's almost 50% on 1990 levels, but the bit that's in front of us is the really hard bit. And like you say, it's going into people's homes. So we've stepped up quite significantly in the buildings decarbonisation work in the Scottish Government. As Roy said, we've had quite increase in our own resources to do that, and we will be doing that as well going forward. So currently, and we are committed to publishing a consultation for regulation in this area shortly. I mean, that was in the programme for government. You know, we estimate currently around 4,000 buildings have zero direct emission heating systems installed annually in Scotland. About half of our non-domestic buildings do have a zero direct emissions heating system. But you're right, the kind of numbers, it's not quite 2 million, but we estimate around 1 million will have to be decarbonised in the course of this decade. So this is enormous. And this is also why we've got a significant programme of support for households, but also businesses. So 1.8 billion over the course of this Parliament to provide support, focusing in the first instance on those who can least afford it through a couple of our schemes. But this is a key area, and we're going to have to significantly pick up the pace on building decarbonisation.
I mean, the scale of it is incredibly challenging, convener Roy. I mean, if it's a million by 2030, that's roughly 150,000 a year we need to do.
It is a big scale.
That's huge. I mean, I'm interested in the public perception and awareness of this as well. Do you think we're doing enough to reach out to the public to make them aware of this, and also to particularly to make them aware of grant assistance that's available at the ground level? Even if there's some money on the table to help people to make the transition, do you feel that they know enough about the choices they can make about the technology? I mean, where do they go for that advice? How do they get it? How do they determine whether to make a transition to another heating system and so on? Could you talk a little bit about that and what the government's doing to try and speed that process up?
So you're absolutely right in identifying people, understanding what they need to do and know where to go for help and advice on that. So we published our heat and energy efficiency strategy a couple of years ago. And since then, and particularly over the last year or so, we've stepped up our engagement and marketing and public information campaigns around heat decarbonisation. So we work together with Home Energy Scotland, who have a website which is the sort of the go-to place for people to get information. We run television adverts, we run sort of campaigns on social media, and we will just be continuing to step this up to help people understand where they can go to get help and support to do the two things we need to do. One is energy efficiency, and that helps keep people's bills down as well and protect people from, you know, variation in temperature, but also to decarbonise the heating systems, which are currently fossil fuel. So we do not underestimate the task involved in helping people to understand this and helping them understand where they can get information.
Just finally, for the record, convener, for the public interest, there is grant assistance available for both the transition to different heating system and for
energy efficiency.
Home insulation.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you know how much is available to
7,500.
Plus interest free loans.
And 7,500. Well, it's all on the Heat Energy Scotland website. So I send you the details, but it's really quite helpful in terms of directing people towards what category an individual might be in and what support would be available. And also, the new contract for Warmer Home Scotland, which we'll launch in the autumn, there'll be a big marketing campaign around that. So we are quite rightly ramping up that societal consciousness of what needs to happen. The consultation that Kirsty mentioned, when it finally comes out, will again bring that to the fore around how are we going to decarbonise this sector and what will be in place to support individuals to make that journey, that change that's been required.
Mm. Finally, on that, which I know we're pressed for time, I mean, it's a huge target per year, if you just articulate it the way I did earlier. Are you confident that we can get there year on year towards 2030 and have that target of a million homes decarbonised by then?
So it's not all within our control. So it is demand-led. So, you know, you require people to kind of walk towards that change. And we also require the supply chain and a manufacturing chain and a workforce to be able to ramp up to those numbers. But that's the kind of strands of work that we've got in place on a programme the scale of heat and buildings. And I know that the Audit General Scotland has started to engage now on that kind of programme work, and I'm sure we'll be back on that. It's to try and look at all those different elements of what it will take to change society in this singular way. Forget about how we move or what we consume or what we manufacture, just in how we live and heat our homes. How do we set up a programme and how do we allow that to deliver on the envelope that's required to meet the net zero target?
Okay, thanks. I'll leave it at that just now, convener, in the interest of time.
But yeah, thank you. I will bring you back in, Willie. One thing that you didn't mention, but I think is quite important as well, is the electric vehicle charging network. And you talked about ramping up when it comes to housing and buildings and so on. But you are selling off Charge Place Scotland and kind of withdrawing from that provision. Why is that and maybe this is a question for that Cabinet Subcommittee, Mr Brannan, I don't know, because it may be a policy question, but why is it that the government is pulling out from that £65 million worth of investment in EV charge points and just handing it over to the private sector?
Yeah, so I don't think that that's a fair reflection of the position, and I think Alison gave you a kind of position on that at the Committee on Major Projects Infrastructure, where she's cited the fact that £65 million has been invested so far to get us to 2,500 public charge points out of the 4,000. That's not lost, so that is still functioning. The transformation is a new strategy in terms of how EV infrastructure is rolled out and the need to use our public finance money in a different way, to lever in that private investment. And having just travelled across Europe over the course of the summer there, you can't help but see that investment that's occurring elsewhere on the French road network, where you've got large private investors investing quite heavily in solar-based EV charging at most of their areas and service stations. And that's the kind of model that we'd like to move towards in Scotland, where you've got a combination of some support left in public funding, but principally private investment in the infrastructure that we need to get to, which is about 6,000 EV charging points over the piece. And the new strategy that was published, Alison mentioned, and that approach is a more accurate reflection, I feel, in terms of that change in policy. It's not about selling off the existing infrastructure.
Okay. I think it might. Some of these international comparisons might be interesting, actually. So as a committee, we might have a look at what other countries do to provide EV charge points. I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie next, but before I do that, I just wanted to ask you, Mr Brannan, you said at the outset that you welcomed the Audit Scotland report. Do you accept all of its findings and recommendations?
Yes, I've said that. I've said that to the Auditor General separately from the session here. I think there was a welcome level of engagement, and Auditor General has indicated, as Audit Scotland, they will continue with that focus on climate change, given it's such an important topic for the country, and that will help us and support us and kind of as we develop our processes. So the timeliness, if it had been a review had been 3 months later, it might have been a different report, because a lot of the things that had been identified were we were starting to put in place as we had established the Programme Management Office. But nevertheless, it's been a really good, helpful, sharp focus for us to look at those recommendations. And as I say, I'm more than happy for the team to continue to engage with the Auditor General's team on those artefacts that we've developed, so that they can allow a support mechanism back to us to say, that looks fine, you've now got an established risk process in place, Climate Change Committee are now managing risk more effectively, so identifying, assessing, action and then reviewing on a more regular basis, and that flows through all the governance structure that's set out in the new governance framework. So, yeah, helpful.
Okay. Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. I've got some more specific questions in governance and capacity, and you have touched on some of the areas in your previous answers, but I'll go through them anyway. So, lines of accountability. So I don't underestimate how complex it is, because it does cut through different directorates. But it means that cross-government collaboration is required to progress climate change policies and manage competing priorities. So the question would be, the extent to which effective cross-government collaboration is taking place to progress both climate change actions and the management of competing policy priorities?
Yeah, so I probably refer back to how I'd articulated the structure of the Global Climate Emergency Board previously. So that now includes all the directors that have accountable responsibility for each of the seven sectors. It also includes Scottish Exchequer. It also includes health colleagues in that space and international colleagues. So that cross-collaboration, as we formulate policy in the board, as we develop advice to ministers, that cross-collaboration is happening at that level of the board of the Climate Change Programme. As we move up into executive team, so as an executive team, we operate in four different modes. One of them has been strategic, one of them is in assurance and delivery, and one of them in investment. Again, those cross-collaboration opportunities occur in those different modes. So whether it's strategic, we will, in fact, I think it's next week, we are at ET on the the current state of play on climate change, both mitigation and adaptation. And that is an opportunity for other Director Generals and their teams to kind of feed into the development of what we take forward next in terms of that journey towards net zero. And the same way that ET delivery scrutinises how we are getting on in delivering just the things that we've got in front of us just now, like heat and buildings, where we did a deep dive with the Permanent Secretary 2 weeks ago, I think it was, on the metrics of that journey to that transformation. Again, that provides an opportunity for that cross-collaboration across government. And then the third area is in budget. So as we are progressing through development of the budget for 24-5 and the capital review heading into 24-5, at ET this week we had a discussion around that capital programme, the development of that capital programme, which by necessity has a number of different pressures in it and competing priorities, and that's that opportunity for us to formulate that advice to go up to Cabinet Secretaries and the DFM and FM on the choices that they ultimately will have to make as ministers.
How often do you have meetings?
ET? Uh-huh. It's cyclic. So it's on a, you know, so ET delivery probably comes around, well, that's every Thursday. ET strategic is on a Tuesday. So it's every kind of four weeks we'll go through ET strategic, ET investment. So there's a cyclic nature of how ET operates. Mm-hmm. But it's Tuesday and Thursday that we come together every week.
So there's enough meetings for people to put points across?
100%, yeah. Right,
okay. When new developments come out, then does that get brought up at meetings? And one of the things I'm thinking about anyway is the heating in buildings. So there was reports in the press recently, and it was talking about heat pumps and whether or not they were actually, whether they're any good for the Scottish climate. So is that kind of some of the things that would be brought up when you're having your meetings to see whether you need to progress with it or to do more?
Yeah, I mean, those are the kind of observations that people unfamiliar with the topic. So, again, my colleague in health, for instance, might provide that external view on climate change activity, heating buildings, not directly relevant in that space. So helpful that you get that different perspective, and kind of that allows the team then to take those ideas or issues and go, OK, we need to do a little bit more around that. Is there more that we can find out to evidence why it is the right thing for us to do in a particular area? So that's why that cross-collaboration is really important. Mm-hmm. And the only other thing I was going to say in terms of frequency, so the Global Climate Emergency Board meets monthly as we develop the policy on our journey towards net zero and scrutinise activity, and then the Climate Subcommittee meets quarterly. So that's, again, those two elements and ET, the linkages are quite strong in terms of activity and transparency to both the upper senior management of the government, but also senior politicians in cabinet.
Thanks. And one of the other questions I did have were minutes taken, but you've kind of answered that. So minutes are now taken of all these meetings, because obviously that would be important for us for scrutinising to make sure that these matters had been raised, and then to see what action had been taken on.
Yeah, minutes were always taken for the Cabinet Subcommittee and always taken for the Global Climate Emergency Board. The DD Board was operating in a more informal way.
Okay. The next question would be what the Scottish Government is doing to better align climate change governance groups with each other and with wider corporate governance arrangements?
Yeah, I think probably my previous answer address that. So the Global Climate Emergency Framework that we've now put in place, which we will share with Audit Scotland for them to look at, that sets out the roles of individuals on the board itself, but how that then interacts with other parts of the corporate governance, including the executive team and the modes that I've just explained there.
Okay. And the last one, how the Scottish Government is improving performance monitoring and reporting to provide assurance and progress towards meeting net zero goals and adapting to climate change?
So there's three things to say there. One, the first is that the start of last year, trying to transform the approach to how we keep a closer handle on what everybody's doing. We developed a dashboard that we were able then to allow ET to see in a kind of snapshot progress towards our targets across the sectors, but more importantly, individual outcomes and inputs that were being undertaken by the likes of transport, agriculture, etc. So development of the new agricultural bill. The evolution of that has has meant that we now have a performance dashboard that is pulled together corporately, which includes a section on climate change, quite a comprehensive section, and again that is considered by the executive team on a regular basis in performance ET. So there is scrutiny of that, those metrics, those data points that we are able to measure at those different parts of the corporate governance structure. And then the third bit, which is the bit that is being developed on the back of the refreshed framework for governance of the Global Climate Emergency Board, is a more specific dashboard that will be fed from each of the boards across the sectors. So, for instance, transport would feed in an array of metrics, including KPIs, measurable outcomes and indicators on a monthly basis, and then reviewed by the Global Climate Emergency Board on a quarterly basis. And I think, going back to the convener's point, that's the kind of artefact that would potentially become public, because that is an articulation of monitoring rather than policy and development.
Okay, thanks. You said a few minutes ago, in answer to my last question, Mr. Brannan, that you accepted in full the recommendations and findings of the Audit Scotland report. One of the starkest passages in the report is on page 16, isn't it? Where, let me quote what the Auditor General finds. The Scottish Government does not routinely carry out carbon assessments or capture the impact of spending decisions on its carbon footprint in the long term. Secondly, the Scottish Government does not assess how far the policies outlined in the climate change plan update will contribute to net zero. And thirdly, the Scottish Government does not know how much the policies proposed in the current climate change plan update will cost. So what was your reaction to that when you read that in the report?
So that is a fair reflection of where we are at the present time. And that was, again, as Kirsty had stated at the Committee on Major Infrastructure Projects, the journey of the climate change plan update coming so quickly after the targets were set in 2019 did not allow, before my time, but it did not allow an articulation of the linkage between the policies and plans in that update and what it would actually demonstrate per sector in terms of outcomes on climate change mitigation. The new plan, the development of the new plan, by law, needs to be in a different space. So we need to be able to articulate in the new plan what each policy will deliver in terms of emissions reduction, and also it needs to be costed. So the weakness that you've reflected there and the Audit General has picked up on is by dint of the timing that took place in development of that first climate change plan update. As we develop the next climate change plan, those two bits will be corrected.
I think the only thing I would add to that, actually not on that, is that is exactly why we commissioned the Fraser of Allander work. I know that, you know, they were very clear coming back to us saying we've got work to do, but they were very clear in the recommendations around what we need to do in relation to spend, but also what we need to do in our policy assessment. So there are kind of three strands on this. How do we assess the budget? How do we evaluate policy on an ongoing, the carbon impact of policy on an ongoing basis, and as Roy said, cost information as part of our climate change plan.
And to be fair, it's not new information. The Climate Change Committee have been saying this for the last two reports, I think. In fact, Chris had said in his report in December that the government need to move, Mr. Stark, it needs to move towards a quantified climate change plan as they develop the new plan. So it's something that has been uppermost in our mind. It's not easy as a government, as a country, to do, but that's the challenge ahead of us, because that's where you get the transparency on both what the policies will deliver in emissions terms, but also what's the totality of the cost of delivering this change, societal wide change.
So what you're saying in summary is that by the time we get the next climate change plan, all of these criticisms will have been addressed.
Correct, yes.
Right, thank you. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much again, convener. Roy, I wonder if I could just turn briefly to risk management, risk assessment. You'll be aware of some of the comments in the Auditor General's report around this, saying something like this: details of many of the planned actions to address risks are vague and do not include intended completion dates or expected impact, there's not a systematic structured process in place for tracking actions and so on and so forth. So to, I had three questions here, which I'll just roll into the one, if that's okay. Convener Roy, how are you identifying, monitoring and reviewing risk so that we can get a clear sight that this has been addressed carefully and properly, and how do you incorporate long-term impacts within the risk management process?
So probably two parts to that answer. The first is, if I talk more generally about how we've set ourselves up as a new DG family and our risk maturity in that family. And I think the report refers back to a maturity assessment back in mid-June, I think it was May or June last year, as being novice organised on a seven-point scale. I think that was a fair reflection at the time of us setting up a new DG family with disparate directorates coming in, not dissimilar to the rest of the government. So the maturity wasn't just done on DG Net Zero, it was done on all the DG's families, and most of them were in a similar position. Since that time, we, which was a, in terms of training and capability, which was one strand of that maturity, we had quite a low uptake of mandatory training on risk awareness across the whole of the 2,500 staff in the family. As we speak, sit here today, we are above 90, I think it's 91% of all staff in A to C band and SCS staff have undertaken that mandatory risk training on identifying, assessing actionable responses and then reviewing risk. So as a DG family, I am comfortable that we are progressing and maturing as a risk approach. We talk about risk on a monthly basis. The DG assurance process, which effectively is my accountable officer process to support me and my duties, we talk about risk on a regular basis there. The weakness that we had, I suspect, that's been identified by the Auditor General was that climate change specifically and the very specific risks from each of the sectors was not being considered by the Global Climate Emergency Board in totality. Although climate change featured both through my risk register, the DG risk register, and escalated to the corporate risk register through the corporate governance structures appropriately. So it's one of the highest for mitigation on the corporate risk register. We review that regularly, as we do with adaptation. And if I could just touch on the difference between adaptation and climate change, they are two different risk scores, but they are both in the red category to the top right-hand side of the matrix. So they're both classed as high. I wouldn't get hung up so much about the likelihood and the impact element. They are both high and treated very similarly in terms of that consideration. So how have we addressed the weakness and how do we capture the risk specifically across the sectors, and then how does Global Climate Emergency Board have an oversight of that? So the Programme Management Office, as I referred to, has now put in place a structured risk approach, which mirrors what we do in the DGE family, mirrors what we do at corporate level. That approach has now been cascaded through the sectors and their boards. Those risks are now flowing up to a climate change specific risk register, which I have in front of me. And again, we're happy enough to share that with Audit Scotland so that they can see sight of how those risks are managed. They will be reviewed on a monthly basis by the Global Climate Emergency Board and then deep dived at a quarterly basis, any risks that are highlighted as being in that actionable area. And probably one of the first ones, and Kirsty's already signalled this, that heat in buildings will probably flow up quite quickly to that kind of position. So I'm comfortable now that we have addressed the specific points within the report, but we need to now socialise that so that it becomes normal activity, as running any major project programme does, so that risk is driving behaviour, if you like, in terms of the right scrutiny that's adopted by the senior team and ministers.
Okay, can I just use one example, Richard, just to put that in context? The example we used before, it must be a huge risk that we don't meet the million transition by 2030. It must be on the risk register, must be. How do people like us and how do the public see the government making progress on that and actions to try to mitigate that? How did he see it? If we were to ask you in another 3 months, how are you getting on with that? How would we see that progress being made to try and mitigate it?
So that comes back to that report that we published on an annual basis, which is it's a kind of backward-looking report on the year previous on all activity. And for heat and buildings chapter of that, for instance, I can't remember how many pages are in it, but it goes through each of the outcomes and indicators that we are measuring ourselves against in terms of that progress. Some of the change it's requiring is not happening on a monthly or weekly basis. So, you know, that kind of societal change that we are talking about takes a much longer period of time. So you couldn't, it would be the same metric every month, effectively, if you were trying to monitor it on that basis. But what you're trying to capture is the trends. Is the trend in a positive way or is the trend in a negative way? And the indicators that are going to be developed by the Programme Management Office will try and give us those kind of telltales of, are we seeing a change happening in the right direction? Is there more zero-emission heating supply chain manufacturers in place? Do we have more heating engineers now going undertaking courses? Whatever the indicators are, and we've not designed all of them yet, but some metric that will allow us that connectivity between what we need to see happening and the inputs that will require it to happen.
Okay. Thank you for that. I'll leave it at that.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to call back in Graeme Simpson. Graeme.
Thanks a lot, Convener. And I think I'll just follow on from Willie Coffey's line of questioning, because he took a keen interest in heating buildings, which I do as well. The government's actually going to be legislating, isn't it, in this area, to force people to get rid of gas boilers at some point. So have you done any analysis on what that will cost individuals?
So I don't think that's a true reflection of the intended policy, but I'll set something out and bring Kirsty in. So there's two pieces of work on the transformation in heating buildings. One is around new build. So we've already had the new build standard in place. So from next year, new build houses will require, within a 3-year window of planning horizon, to have a zero emission heating system in place. So legislation will drive some of the behavioural change. The piece of legislation that we are formulating just now, that is being considered by ministers, will take it to that domestic level and private level in terms of buildings. What is it that we will use as levers through that legislation, which will be scrutinised through the consultation and by Parliament, to determine the appropriate mechanism to try and change that behaviour, because it won't happen on its own. But Kirsty.
My question, but carry on.
Yeah, so as I said, we will be publishing a consultation on the bill. You know, we announced that in the programme for government, and we will, you know, set out information on costs and on that as well. Look, there's the overall transformation to net zero is a really, really significant transformation, and as we've talked about, there are, you know, really significant costs associated with that. But that is what you know, the Parliament has signed up to in relation to our climate change targets. We have, I can give you the figure for the assessment of the overall cost of the net zero transformation in buildings to 2045. We estimate that is about $33 billion.
I think that figure
has that has been public a few times.
But how does that translate to individuals? I'm not talking about new builds, because if we deal with that is different,
yeah,
to
100%, yeah,
existing homes,
yeah, yeah,
where people will be expected to do things which will could cost a lot of money.
And that's
legislation that's forcing them to do that.
Well, that's the formulation of the policy that ministers need to take forward to address the targets that were set by Parliament. So, quite rightly, all of that will be scrutinised through the parliamentary process, including how far and what measures need to be taken forward. But I think you'll recognise that without some form of either incentive and process to change society, we won't change alone. You know, we've seen that in terms of the bounce back on how we move ourselves as a country. We've seen a bounce back from COVID times now, where the use of the motor car has increased again since pre-pandemic levels. So you will necessarily, in each of these sectors, have a requirement to do something that both incentivises but also supports but also encourages the change that's required.
Okay. So we can't today give us that figure that I'm seeking?
Yeah, so we'll set that out as part of the consultation.
At some point. Yeah. Mr. Coffey mentioned this million homes by 2030 being decarbonised figure. Where does that figure come from?
So that is from our, I think that was in our heat and buildings strategy. So that was the estimate. But if you think about it, you know, buildings count for 20% of our emissions. It's not that hard to do the maths. You know, that we have about 2.6 million homes, I think, in Scotland. Yeah. And given our 2030 climate change targets, which is that we need to reduce emissions by 75%, you know, we are going to have to go out pretty hard in all sectors to meet these targets.
Well, I suppose going back to, you know, Mr. Coffey gave a very interesting figure of 150,000 homes a year would need to be decarbonised to hit that target.
Yeah.
Have you done an analysis of what that would cost?
So you know, we're working through, you know, the ranges we need to. So the current figure that is in the public domain is around a million homes by 2030, and we're doing further. You know, we're doing analysis as we're working through the policy measures that would need to be put in place to achieve these, and, you know, doing costing associated with that.
So is there no cost?
So not that I can share now, but we will be sharing information
as part of the consultation and part of the work on the development of the heat and buildings policy. But but it's not. I mean, if you again coming back to the tenant point, which is there a calculation between the emissions reduction required in heat and buildings and actually what do you need to practically do? Yes, there is. So fundamentally, we need to go from a certain amount of tonnage per CO2 in heat and buildings to a point in 2030, its envelope, and then you then are able to then calculate what does that actually mean in practical terms, and that's where the million homes comes from.
Yeah, but that's just a figure. I mean, this is my problem with all this. We come up with sort of figures, but what we don't know what it means for the individual, and we don't know, because you haven't given us any figures, what the cost of that will be, and how much, if anything, government is prepared to help people with. We don't know any of that.
Yeah, that's part of the consultation, the heat and buildings consultations. That's the development of the policy.
Set the targets.
Consultation out, to set the legislation in front of Parliament and society for the Parliament to then go, okay, we accept that's what's going to be required to meet the Parliament's targets and the delivery plan to do that.
And just to be clear, you know, it is a consultation. So it will, you know, it will set out the scale of the challenge, and the scale of the challenge flows from our overall climate change targets to what each of the sectors need to do. And it will set out, you know, clearly what the scale is in the different sectors.
In a similar way to the 20% reduction in vehicle kilometres, you know, we will set out at the end of the year what that roadmap is, what that plan is, and what the levers will be to deliver that plan. So climate change, in any of all countries across the world, it's a similar thing. So there's a journey to net zero, there's a calculation to be done on emissions reduction per sector. The key bit thereafter is the plan to deliver that. And I liken it to the Queen's Ferry Crossing. So you need foundations, towers, deck and cables for a bridge. In a similar way to get us to net zero, you need those similar building blocks. And that's what the team are working through just now with ministers and policy and legislation development are those key building blocks. What is it that we need to do specifically in these areas? And that's what Mr. Stark at the Climate Change Committee and their colleagues have been asking us to produce. And that's what will be produced as part of the new plan.
Well, quite. I was actually going to ask you about that target of cutting up car miles. I always say miles because that's what we use in this country, not kilometres. There must have been discussions about the specific actions that you think need to be taken to achieve that kind of target in what is now less than 7 years?
On car kilometres?
Yeah, car miles.
Yeah, demand management. That's the kind of the different policies that will be brought forward as part of that development of the strategy will be those things that, again, putting out to society, here are the things that we will need to necessarily do to deliver on that plan. There is no other There is no other bag of things. There's no other bag of tricks to do this. These are pretty fundamental building blocks that we're going to have to do as a society.
Okay. I've got one more question, Convener. I just want to ask you, we've been asking you about various committees earlier on. There's another one I want to ask you about, which is the Green Heat Finance Task Force. Can you tell us what that does?
Yep. So the Green, we talked about the cost of decarbonising buildings, and we've also talked about the importance of bringing private finance into that. So the task force looks at ways in which we can bring public sector finance. So that can be, you know, investment where the parties who invest get returns, but also how people can help smooth the costs of the investments that they may need to make to decarbonise their buildings. So, you know, things like green mortgages. So how do we develop financial products that help us all manage this transition and manage and smooth the costs of that transition?
And has this task force actually achieved anything yet?
Yes, well, so it will be producing its report fairly soon.
Another report that we've yet to see. So
that will be published soon.
Soon?
Yeah.
What do you mean by soon?
I expect it next month or so, next couple of months,
if not before. Specific actions? What kind of thing can we expect
to see? What it does is it's looked very carefully at what the different options are to help finance the transition, specifically in buildings. And there will be more work to do coming out of that. Nobody's pretending that this is easy. We'd love it as policy officials to be easy. So we will be continuing to work through with external parties, with other parts of the Scottish Government, parties like Scottish Futures Trust, the First Minister's Investment Panel, to continue to develop the work on how do we bring in, as Mr. Beattie said, private sector investment,
that's right.
And how do we help smooth this? So working with financial institutions, banks, mortgage providers, and others.
And there's some good examples of that already in the marketplace. There's just not enough of them, and they're not again socialised to the extent. So the task force will have done that piece of work for us to identify the things that we need to pursue in a bit more detail.
Okay, well, I look forward to reading that in the next month.
Or so.
Or so.
Right, thank you.
We've got a final couple of questions, which I think Willie Coffey is going to put to you. Willie.
Thanks again, Convener. It's just a query on the infrastructure investment plan, and we announced it in 2021. There was £4.4 billion set aside at that time. It's since been extended to £4.7 billion, but we're quite a way through the programme now. But according to our colleagues in Spice, the government's only spent about 13% of that total allocation. It's just to ask you about that, Roy. Is that your understanding, and what are we doing to accelerate that spend?
So again, referring back to the evidence you heard at the infrastructure investment hearing just before recess, I think Alison Cumming gave you a kind of response in that space to say cabinet, the capital is under review at the present time. Some of the schemes where we had capital allocated, demand-led, haven't materialised in the same space as we, I think Kirsty had said that previously around, you know, the heating buildings, energy efficiency capital, for instance, hadn't come forward in the plan that we'd thought they would come forward in. So that probably is a recognition of a combination of things. One, less uptake, and two, movement in capital programmes more generally. So if things move to the right, or things need to move to the right to rebalance the capital spend, then you'll get that slip in infrastructure investment. And the capital review that's underway just now will take a look and cognizance of capital across the piece, including on net zero activity.
Yeah. So I can come in. I can't talk across the whole capital investment plan, but just to give a couple of examples from our areas. As Roy said, We had some underspend in heat and buildings. The point you raised about the importance of public awareness, we've significantly stepped up our public awareness and marketing campaigns, marketing, i.e. providing people with information, and we've seen a significant uptick in the uptake of the capital spend on the heat and buildings side. On the energy side, there was, and this does apply across the capital investment, you know, some of it was impacted by COVID and supply chain disruption, so that has contributed at least to some extent to that. But again, we're seeing an uptake as we've sort of come out of COVID.
I mean, it's quite, I don't want to, well, call it an underspending. It's 13%. That's a huge difference. Yeah. I mean, is it even possible to catch up? Because you're talking about substantial amounts of money to catch up on all that commitment that was in the investment plan in 2021. How on earth do you catch up to that degree with such sums that are available to you?
Well, as I say, I think as Alison Cummings has set out there, that the capital spending review that's been undertaken now in parallel with the setting of the budget for 4-5 is reflecting on what priority programmes and projects are required now to deliver on the government's priorities, which are across the three tenets of the First Minister's programme for government.
And do you think there's sufficient private and public sector uptake, though, or has that been slow, and for the reasons that you've outlined earlier, can we accelerate that and get participation, ramp it up a bit to make sure that the money's spent where it needs to be?
100%, if we can get, and again, it's unfortunate DG Economy is not here, because I think that he would have quite a bit to say on that investor market, and actually the effort that's going in to secure, through some pump priming by Scottish Government public funds, that level of investment that you're going to require to deliver on some of these programmes.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks. I mean, I know, Mr Brannan, you've reflected on the fact that we had an evidence session just before the recess on major capital projects, which covered some of this ground. But I'm asking you, as the accountable officer, the Director General of Net Zero, how do you account for some of those figures that we saw? I mean, if I, you know, look, emergency energy technologies, planned expenditure, £180 million, actual spend, £10 million. Low carbon manufacturing challenge fund, planned expenditure, £26 million, actual expenditure, £750,000. Heat network, planned expenditure, £300 million, actual spend, £6.4 million. And finally, the Future Transport Fund bus priority investment, planned expenditure, £495 million, actual spend, £26 million. I mean, you're in charge of this. What's your reaction to that?
So I think, you know, you recognised last year that there was quite a substantial reset in terms of spend to budget that the former DFM had undertaken, and some of that will be reflected in the pace and scale of how those programmes have progressed. The last one there you mentioned in terms of the bus fund, I think we thought there'd be a greater uptick from, and most of these things that you've read out are demand-led, so we thought there'd be a greater uptick from both local authorities and bus partnerships to kind of develop that infrastructure that's required. And there's quite some, in some of these cases, there's quite long lead-ins to develop that kind of bus infrastructure projects. But I think there's probably a combination of a number of things there, and that is the nature of capital programmes more generally. So you get movement, you get reprioritisation, you need to keep your capital programme under review constantly, which is what the government has been doing, what policy officials have been advising ministers in that space and have been doing. So it's not through an under scrutiny of the capital programme, it's a combination of a number of things. But on Kirsty's side, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I mean, I can come in. So I think some of these figures were spent to date and then costs over the Parliament. So to pick up on one example, our Emerging Energy Technologies Fund, which is £180 million over this Parliament. So we've put out, and that's going to be spent on hydrogen and carbon capture and storage. So we have awarded funding for the innovation part of hydrogen. And we will be awarding, you know, funding of the larger part of the hydrogen spend as we go forward. So it takes time. These things are often announced early in Parliament, and we need to get it right because these are big sums of money. So I firmly expect we'll see sort of this significant uptake in that. And just again to use that fund as an example. It was carbon capture and storage as well as hydrogen. So on carbon capture and storage, we did need the UK government to move and provide a bit more certainty around the likelihood of business model support for the Scottish cluster. So sort of until we had a bit more movement there, it was quite difficult for us to really assure ourselves that we were spending that money in the most effective way.
Okay, well, look, on that note, I will draw this morning's evidence session to a close. Can I thank Roy Brannan, Kirsty Burge and Phil Raines for your time and your input this morning. It's been very helpful for us. It may be that there are a few things that we'd like to follow up with you, which I'm sure you will be happy to cooperate with us on. So I would like to close the public part of this morning's meeting and move the committee into private session. Thank you.